Hi, everybody. So my daughter and I woke up this morning and we were sort of bummed out. We're tired of this. So it makes us happy to go get aaay bowls. So we're going to go do that. My daughter's driving. I actually haven't driven since my procedure. But we're on our way. And we're going to be really happy afterwards.
And you have to remember the difference between each of those 20 things. Except with him, those 20 things are named in Latin. And there's 150 of them.
But when you sort them, do you have to put them in order?
You don't have to put them in order. You just have to remember the thing that I do is I remember one thing about each of them, and usually the rest of the information is attached to that one thing, if that makes sense.
So that's a trick you use.
Yeah. But it's not, the sorting mechanism is not something that a lot of people's brains have naturally, I've noticed.
I see.
Beyond the differential diagnosis list, but it's good to pare it down that way.
Cool.
Anyway, he's really smart and doesn't realize how smart he is.
So you said this year is going to be his last year?
I think so.
What a bad way to go out.
I know. I'm actually really sad that I missed his last live lecture.
Maybe he'll change his mind.
I don't think he will. The way he ended his last live lecture, which I watched on the internet, was, if you don't see me when you come back from spring break, well, you know what happened.
Oh. Yeah, thought he was going to die?
Yeah.
Oh, that's terrible.
I know. He has a really dark sense of humor.
You know, I could have said that too.
I know.
So here we are. The juice bar. That's where we get these things, and they're called aaay bowls. Oh, they are so good. Chocolate, peanut butter. I guess I'm giving these guys free advertising. We're somewhere on brand, and so my 100 plus subscribers. Thanks, by the way. I got a little note from YouTube saying, you've just got your 100th subscriber. Little do they know, they're supposed to be going to my class, but yeah. Here we go. I'm excited. I don't get out much. Wow. Did Jack FM come back? More culture. What band is this? It's a quiz. And a hint. From my favorite town. I'll tell you at the end. There we go. My aaay bowl, watching my This Is Living episode. Rita's joined me. My wife is still in quarantine in the back of the house. Sad. But the food is good. Oh, a crime. So Rita and I mixed up our two aaay bowls. She had Almond Brother, I had peanut butter. And then we switched them by mistake, and she doesn't like peanut butter, and she left that. That's so sad.
Hey, buffet. So, oh, that rhymes. I like that. Couple comments. First, I've talked to some people who have skipped episodes, and I wouldn't do that. Because when I make them, I think about what's been done, and then I build upon past ones. So if you think you're behind and you need to catch up and so you'll just jump over some episodes, don't do that, please. Because I remember there really isn't any time in buffet. You should be doing this when it fits in. And, you know, like if your other classes are like driving you crazy and you got tests or whatever, an AP test or whatever, and that's stressing you out, well, you should do that. And then when you feel more relaxed and you're ready to do this, come back, but don't jump, because it'll be a train wreck that you'll, you know, you'll be building a house and you'll make a roof and there'll be nothing below it. And who wants to live at a house with only a roof? I am a little worried about communication. So let me talk positively first. There is a large group of you that are following, doing the labs as fast as I can send them out. And hello to you, all you guys, and nice work. And unless I hear from you, I'm not gonna worry about you. There's another significantly large group who is not doing that. And I'm trying to chase you down because there's some that have done none. And it's likely they're not even listening to this. So why am I even saying it? Good question. But I am going to try to change a few things to help the communication. And one of them, not a change, but I've mentioned it, we're going to use Discord. And I'm going to move a buffet into this very soon. And I'll show you what it looks like from my perspective. This probably looks really confusing, but I made a group, or called servers, and I called it Neato's Buff Club. So what I'm hoping is that everybody in buffet will get an account, and once you get an account, you'll be invited to join this server, which is just a place where we can talk. And in the next episode, we're going to talk about this in detail. And this primarily is for gamers, but I am not a gamer and I'm digging it. So it is a great place to communicate. You can talk to people one-on-one. You can text people one-on-one. You can text people in a group. You can talk to people in a group, and you can talk with a video camera. So all that can happen. And what I'm hoping is it'll be a place where you can ask questions and get answers and also socialize. So that's the vision. And if you look down here in the lower left corner, this is me. My username is Neato, and my user number is 2736. So if you learn enough on what that means, you can get an account and then friend me, and then I will see you, and then I will accept your friendship, and you'll be in the club, and you'll be on your way. Like I said, next episode, we will talk more about that. So now what I want to do is dive into the next exercise in Unity. And how do I want to do that? Let's go. It turns out there's a lot of art stuff in Unity, you know, like making pictures in paint, or, you know, whatever your medium is. And then like getting rid of the backgrounds, and we're eventually going to make animations. So I just went back to the old fashioned way to start this. So I just double clicked on the Unity icon on the desktop, and I still only have one project called First. And I still think that's the right way to do this. Otherwise, I would have made more projects. And this one opened up to the scene that I call Grav. And you can see I've got a bunch of scenes saved. I have background. I have play with assets. That's probably from the beginning. And I have this one called Grav. So the last one I played with, which was on my own, by the way, so it wasn't the last one in the video, was Grav. So what we're going to do now is we're going to talk about the hierarchy. And again, this is another tool in your tool bag. So we're going to make a game object out of pieces. So I'm going to make a Neato. And the first thing I'm going to do is go up to where it says game object. And I'm going to say create empty. And that's going to go put an empty game object in my hierarchy here. And then I'm going to double click it so that I can name it. So I'm going to call it Neato. Okay, so I'm going to make a me. But right now it's empty. Like, you don't see it anywhere over here. And now what I'm going to do, very important, is it's selected, but it's the invisible man. I'm going to go over here and I'm going to make sure that its transform position is 0. So that guy is going to be 0, and that guy is going to be 0, and that guy is going to be 0. Okay, so now this mysterious new thing I'm going to make is going to be centered at the origin. Now, I've done some work. I made something called a TBH. I forget what that stands for, but transparent buffoon head. That's what that is. Okay, and so that's going to be the head on Neato, and I'm going to drag this and put it somewhere. I made the center of this near the origin, and I'm going to put the head. I'm just dragging it. Okay, so there's my head, and you can see TBH is over here, and I'm going to rename that now. I didn't want to do that. How does that go back? That would be a good thing to know. I just automatically zoomed it. Like a view. How do we go back? Somebody there knows. I wonder if I can do this and go back to default. Oh, bingo. Anytime something happens and you're not happy with it, this is my little favorite. Go over to this place and hit default, and then everything seems better. Okay, so I'm going to, he's laughing at himself. Bad. Or maybe it's not bad. Whoa. Okay, there's my little triangle. Boom. All right, so I want to rename this, and how do I rename that? There. Good. Okay, I'm going to call that head, because that's what's it. It's a head. And I still got my problems over here with my default. There we go. And so it's called, notice this little triangle, hide stuff. That's everything in the scene. Peekaboo. Okay, so there's the head. Now, I'm going to select the head. And I'm worried my head is too small. His brain's so small. Make his brain bigger. Boom. Whoa. Okay, so I just pulled my head. Turbo pull. Ouch. Voodoo. And so I enlarged my head by 3 times by adjusting the scale. Okay. So let me comment on my head, though. As you can see, it's just the outline of my head. So I'm going to tell you quickly what I did. I went to Paint. Here's Paint. Paint is your friend. And there's a pair of legs. I went to File, Open, and I went and found Buffoon Head, or Buffoon something, Buffoon JPEG. Maybe it's this. Boom. Oh, shoot, that's Post. File, Open. Is there just Buffoon? I just want Buffoon. Buffoon. Boom. Yeah, there we are. So this is good. You'll get a little bit. If you're new at this, maybe you'll learn something. So there's my head. Yeah, if you know this stuff, you just fast forward. This on a fast speed would be good. So I clicked resize, and that's proportional. I just cut it by 50%, and I'm going to do it by 50% again. And there we go. And then what I did is I picked the eraser tool, and I went in here. Whoops. There we go. And this will erase the background. And I'm not going to do it like while you watch, because it'll take forever. But it's like a cooking show. I'm going to say, okay, and after you cook it for an hour and a half. So that's how I did that. Let's see. I might have brought it to Lunapic. Yeah, I had to bring it to LunaPic because the background was white. And so I clicked the background and that left me with this guy, which is a clear background. This is my asset. And then I imported it. That's how I did that. I did a similar thing with the pants. Okay, so I drew a groovy set of pants. I look like an elf. And I drew that in paint. And then I went into LunaPic and I clicked the background so that I would just see the pants, not the background, because I wanted just the pants. So that made this thing. And I might have had to crop it again inside paint, because sometimes you get this gigantic background that you don't need. So you can go into paint and yeah, let me demonstrate that. So like here, yeah, this is it right here. So these pants are like big, this whole page is like pants and I don't want that. So I can go in here and I can say, select, let's see, the lazy way to do it is select rectangle. So that just puts a box around it. You can do freeform if you want to. And then just put a box around there and then say crop, boom. And then that just makes it that big. Yay. So there's a lot of art stuff here. Okay, so then I got rid of the background and I'm going to put some pants on me. Probably a good idea. Okay, so now in the Y direction, I'm going to blow these things up. So I'm going to make them like, whoa, maybe not that big. Boom. Perhaps with a little X. Boom. Oh, perfect. Okay, so there's my pants. And I'm going to drop that a little bit lower. And I can do that, I think, by just dragging like that. Good. Okay. And okay, now here's the magic of this lesson. We're going to talk about parents and children. So this object, remember, this is a game object. And if we were in class right now, I'd say, what type of it? And you would say, it's an empty game object. Because Neato isn't anything. But we're going to make this the parent object. And we're going to take the head, which is this guy, and we're going to put it in there. I have the left mouse key down, and I'm going to drag this into Neato, and you'll see that it got indented there. And this is called the child, and this is the parent. And I'm going to do the same thing with this guy, and I'm going to change this to body. More descriptive, and I'm going to grab this and put this into Neato too. So now you can see that Neato, the game object Neato, has a head and a body, and now it's this whole thing. Okay, and then you might say, well, why do that? Well, pretty soon we're going to make animations, like maybe the next lesson, we're close, and you can make an animation, like you could make some legs that are running. And that would be part of this, but then you'd also have some art that was like this, a photo of your face or something else that was made up a bunch of pieces. And then you want to treat that whole thing as one unit. And that's what I want to demonstrate to you now. So like if I click on Neato, come on, baby. If I click on Neato here, first of all, let me show you this little groovy triangle. Boom. That hides everything. So it looks nice and neat. Like you don't know it's got all those pieces. Click the triangle again. Oh, there's the parts. But when I click on Neato, the transform over here is for all of Neato. So if I go in here and I say, I'm going to rotate the whole Neato by 45 degrees, it takes my parts. And I could have 100 parts in here, and it's going to rotate them all together. In contrast, if I went in here and said, you know, I think he looks silly with the right, with an upside, a right side up head. I'm going to take his head and I'm going to invert it. Boom. And now he looks much better. And so if I were to go back to Neato again and say, I want to shift his body, I do, but now his head's upside down. Okay, so that's the point of this lesson. Is to understand how to make a parent and then the children of an object and arrange them in a way so you can't adjust them, but realize that you're either adjusting the whole object if you click up here, and that's the transform of the whole object, or if you're working on individual parts. So the next lab, and this isn't stated explicitly in the PowerPoints, okay, so you're gonna hear it here. But for the next lab, what I'd like you to do is take the game object that you made in the previous lab. I told you to make a game object that had three parts to it, but you didn't know what a hierarchy was with parenting and children. So you would have had three separate pieces over here in the left hand in the hierarchy thing that you moved together. What I'd like you to do now is go put those three pieces together, give them each separate names. I guess they already have separate names, but make this arrangement that we have here. Make an empty game object, give that a name, and then put the three pieces in. So you get a little bit of practice of making a parent with these sub pieces in it. And if you don't like the game object you made in the previous lab, make a new one. Okay, and also think about in the big picture, you're hopefully leading up to a cool game. And so if you have an idea of a character you wanna make, do that, because you can use, as you can see with the assets, we've just been accumulating these things over and over, and it'll just get crazier and crazier. So make a character with at least three pieces, and then I want you to play your movie. And as of right now, it should be static. And I want you to take a picture, do a print screen of this, and then send me that JPEG to Edmodo. I'll put out an Edmodo blast and I'll see your groovy character. Hey, AP. So I really like the format of what happened last time. So I'm gonna follow that again and we're gonna do another problem. So I'm gonna present the problem at the beginning of the discussion right here while I'm babbling. In fact, I'll put page one up. And so you can do whatever, you can look at it, you can hit pause, and then I'm gonna say a few comments about it, and then you should hit pause on the video, on the vlog, and then try to do the problem, and then I'll have the solution. Okay, so I recommend strongly that in this exercise, you pretend that this is a real AP test to get you in that mode, and that means you should time it. So, somehow do that with your phone. This question is going to be like the second one. So you're going to have 15 minutes to do it and then 5 minutes to submit it. So that's the first page of the question. Here comes the second. And again, remember that you can hit pause while this is running so you can read it and go back and check what you're doing. Also, try to make a decision about whether you're going to try to implement it using an IDE or a Notepad++ with an R and a C so that you can test it, or whether you're just going to try to do what they ask. And then here's the third page. So, So I strongly recommend, like I said, you do this. And when the video continues from this point on, it's going to be the solution. Spoiler alert. So you shouldn't go beyond here if you want to have the experience of doing the quiz, which I highly recommend. Hi, everybody. So this is going to be the answer to the question that I just posed, the free response question. And I'm first going to talk about what happened with me, because I hope that you can learn from me. So I looked at this question and the first thing I thought was, I can implement this, because this one looked manageable. I looked at the class, I looked at the methods, and I thought, oh yeah, I have my compiler, I can set it up. So I did. And the bottom line is, you have 15 minutes on this question, and I finished it in 45. So the teacher didn't even finish it in time. And then I was compiling and running and doing different tests and stuff to see if it worked at all the boundaries and everything. And then it was an hour and 15 minutes before I was like completely done. So this is where the College Board is smart. And I think what they're going to do is give you guys a problem where it may look like it's good to compile it and run it and implement the whole thing. But if you get caught in that and you start wrestling with system.outprints and semicolons and stuff like that, you're just going to waste a whole bunch of time that's taken away from actually getting the answer to the question that they're asking for. So hopefully if you didn't experience the same thing as me, or maybe you did it faster than me and you were able to get it all implemented, but I would strongly discourage you from trying to implement the whole class in these questions and just go after the thing that they're asking for. Write a method, write the method. And so the thing you should be trying to figure out here is, do you want to handwrite it and take a picture of it with your phone? Or do you want to type it into Notepad++ and then send the file in? Those kind of details, but it doesn't seem like it's a good idea to implement the problem and then compile and run it. So given that I did do that, I'm going to show you the whole thing because, you know, you have the advantage of having the whole system running. So here's my starter, and I call simulate, and then I call run simulations. And now I'm going to go to my frog simulation class, and I wrote some methods, and hop distance is a random number that could be plus or minus. And I had two versions of simulate. So one of them that used a for loop that was fairly simple, and one that used a while loop that was terribly complicated. So here's one answer. And since you have the video, I'm not going to go through and explain stuff so you can study it. But I believe this is one version of simulate that does what it's supposed to do. And then I had a second version that uses a while loop, and that goes here. And you can see I have system.outprints in here because I was doing all this testing, and that I don't think was a good choice. But that's why, so I think from here on out, until test day, it's probably a good idea to practice things like this. And I'm going to encourage it on the log episodes. I'm probably going to keep doing what I'm doing here, where I give you a problem and then give you the solution. But here's another answer to simulate using a while loop. And in here, we have to do conditions on both the distance and the number of hops. And so the if statements are a little more complicated. And then part B was easy. So hopefully that's something that will repeat itself. And yeah, I've seen that before. So part B is right here. And it's basically calling part A over and over. And there is part B. And watch the integer. If you make the counter variable a double, then this is automatically going to come out a double. If it's an int, then you have the possibility of dividing an int by an int and losing a half point there. So this count, just make the counter a double, and that'll work out right. Either the numerator or the denominator needs to be a double. Okay, there we have it. So AP, one more thing. After doing all the work of implementing the problem, I didn't show you the benefit, which is that you can see the solution. So here's a run that has the code all implemented. And remember, this took me an hour and 15 minutes to get it all working and debugged with all my SOPs. But you can see here, this is how much the frog hops each time. And then this is the cumulative distance that it jumps. This is the jump number. And you can see that by the time the frog does five jumps, he got to 14, and boy frog, he, and then the number was 24. So 14 is less than 24, in the maximum amount of jumps allowed. So that's a false. Punchline, not worth it. Remember that it took me an hour and 15 minutes to get the complete end-to-end thing running with all my system.out prints and figure out how to make a pop method and all that stuff. And that's not what you should do. So hopefully you'll learn from my mistake. Good luck.
Hey, sports fans. Here's our latest numbers. So from Mrs. Carlson, she just made her 103rd mask. And for folding at home, you can see the number written on the screen, but it's over 2 million points. And we have 8 machines now working, crunching protein folding algorithms, contributing to our CV folding team. So that is just too cool. So when I decided to do this vlog format, one of the things that I needed help with was I wanted to use it as a means of taking attendance. And so the comment, as I hope you understand now, is the way I track you. And so I get these comments on the YouTube channel. And what I posed to superAP was, hey, I want to get a Excel spreadsheet. Write a program that takes all of these comments and puts them into a spreadsheet so that I can see the person's name, the date they made the comment. If they have any questions, it would go in a dedicated column, and I'd have a column of the comments. And here's what I got.
Hey, what's up, y'all? It's Tony from Dr. Neat's first period class. You might know me from the Falcon Dev Club or the Verdun team at the hackathon at USC. I just wanted to show you guys how I made a little program to help Dr. Neat out during the quarantine. So what I made was a YouTube comment logger so that Dr. Neat can take attendance of who's watching his vlogs. And for all the buffet guys watching, I use Python, so if some of this looks familiar, you know, probably not, but it's okay. Yeah, I'm using Python with Google's YouTube Data API. The reason I'm making this video is to show you guys a more real-life application of Dr. Neat's class and how to use what you learned in his class in the outside world, sort of. So one example, more specific to the AP kids, is how to use code other people wrote in your own projects. And Dr. Neat showed you guys this through 11s, actually. So if I go to 11s, when you were given the 11s folder, you were given board.java, right? And you guys never wrote, you know, deck size or card add or replace selected cards. You used Dr. Neat's methods inside 11's board.java, if you guys remember, where you guys actually made the game 11s. And what Dr. Neat was trying to teach you guys was how to use what we call libraries in the programming world, or like big chunks of code someone else wrote to make your life a little easier. You used libraries before, and maybe you just haven't realized it yet. Like ArrayLists, you guys, yeah. ArrayLists, it says import java.util.ArrayList. It's a standard Java library, and Easy Reader is also uses a different Java library called Scanner. And my code, and a lot of code written outside of the scope of the AP curriculum, uses libraries all the time. So in my code, let's see, I used XLSX Writer, right? And if you guys don't know what XLSX is, it's the extension of Microsoft Excel spreadsheets. And like here, heading format.setBold. I never wrote the method .setBold, right? And how I figured it out was through the XLSX documentation online. Actually, I could just look it up. Right, so if I looked up XLSX Writer setBold, right? And I click on the first one for the documentation. And if I control F and look for set bold, let's go down. Right here, there's just a bunch of methods that I never wrote, right? Like set font name, set size, font size, font color, and here set bold. And if I click to it, it'll just jump right there and it tells me how to use it, what it does, and, you know, in code, and what it looks like. So it's all there, it's all out there for you guys. There's a lot of libraries like this. Another cool library that I've used could be like config parser, What this allowed me to do is to create a config file, right? So in the root folder, if I go to config.ini and I open it, you can see it says is alphabetized. I could set that to true, and what that would do is it would alphabetize my spreadsheet of all the names and all the people that get scraped from the YouTube comments, and I can change the font and whatnot, right? So hopefully you guys learned a thing or two about programming and libraries, and Dr. Neat is going to show you guys how the program works. Thanks, guys.
Okay, so I received from Tony this folder, and it's full of all these files. He wrote all this stuff. There's a README file, and there's a file called run.bat. And this is equivalent to the run file that you use when you compile and run your Java programs. And I'm going to double click that. And what it does is it prompts me for the URL of the video, what I want to look at. So here's my channel. Here's all my things. I'll take your Zeek one. I'm going to right click on it, and I'm going to say copy link address. And then I'm going to say bye-bye, and then I'm going to paste that in right there. And I'm going to hit enter, and this is exciting. So watch, when I hit enter, an Excel spreadsheet is going to magically appear inside this folder. There it is, with today's date on it, the 22nd, 4/22. There it is. And then I open this puppy up, and this is the spreadsheet that has all of those comments in it. Person's name, the comment, the date they made the comment, and any questions they might have. So this, I am a happy customer. Tony did what I wanted. And I got a few comments on that. This didn't happen in the first try. We had four versions, I think. And the first couple, there were issues related to Python. Tony was working on a machine that was his own, and he thought, hey, maybe we should try on a school machine. So I actually met him at school, and he pulled one of those of the 40 we have there to test it. There was another issue where I actually was not logging in as the administrator when I did the command prompt. So that was actually me making a mistake in using it, teach the teacher. And he actually taught me how to be the administrator at a command prompt. And then the last version I got was after it was working, and I was happily marching away, taking my attendance. And he realized I had to do a bunch of steps, and he thought he could simplify it. So the latest version was Tony imagining that I would want some new features that I didn't ask for. He anticipated what I want, and he was right. The latest version is like, all I have to do is hit that run button, and boom, I get the Excel spreadsheet. And the previous versions, I had to type some more stuff and click some things with some handshake with Google that he overcame. So obviously, Tony is our vlog hero for this week. He really embraced a very nebulous problem. He didn't have any idea how to do this. And hopefully you could put yourselves in the shoes when I first introduced this. Here's a YouTube page. Here's a bunch of comments. I want them inside a spreadsheet. And he jumped in and did that. And then he was driven by the customer. He was trying to make sure I was happy. And the game was not done until, I said thank you. And then he went even further because he tried to make the product better. And, that's somebody who you want on your team. Nice job, Tony.